Tonight, the full inside story of the Joanna Yates murder investigation from the detectives who solved it.
It was one of those investigations where it just gripped you from the start, really.
He was telling me things that he hadn't told me on previous conversations, which I thought was odd. I had a very strong gut feeling that something wasn't right.
And in an exclusive interview with Crimewatch, Joe's parents described the terrible moment when they heard their daughter's body had been found.
She was, like, dumped there like a piece of garbage. That's where my daughter was last.
I was thinking, why, you know? There seems to be no reason to it. Yeah, these birds which sort of run along the ground working so hard and then they take to the air and start flying, and that to me is my daughter. She'd just taken off and somebody shot her down.
Welcome to Crimewatch. The murder of Joanna Yates just before Christmas last year gripped the nation. Well, tonight, for the first time, the police speak candidly about how they caught her killer, Vincent Tabak. And we hear firsthand what it was like for Joe's family to be at the centre of that huge media storm. That's all coming up soon. But first, let's take a look ahead to tonight's main appeals. The Wild West-style shootout that killed an innocent man as he was on the phone to his girlfriend.
Rico!
Just cut out, so I thought maybe he's dropped his phone and the battery's always broken. That's why I can't get through to him. I wish that the phone conversation that we had was more, I don't know, like a better last conversation, if you know what I mean.
So, can you name the gunman responsible? The detectives here in the studio also want to know whether a newborn baby found dead in Kirkham in Lancashire just a few weeks ago had been killed. He was discovered in a stream wearing his little top, identical to this one. And later we'll have excellent news on cases solved, thanks to your calls.
Yes, and they include several arrests as a result of our last programme and a 5-year sentence for this thug, found guilty of slashing a doorman in the face so brutally he required 50 stitches.
And, of course, Rav's here with lots of new wanted faces and CCTV. Rav.
Yeah, we got people wanted for murder and armed robbery and this bright spark who was callous enough to burgle a cancer charity shop.
We'll also have a reconstruction of an appalling case of mistaken identity in which a 14-year-old boy was kneecapped as he answered a knock at his front door.
That evening, I was just on the computer while my sister was watching some TV. Basically, a normal night for us.
Really unbelievable. And can you identify this man? He's believed to have planted suspect devices in Canterbury. Neither exploded, but police urgently need to find him before he tries again. But we start tonight with the truly shocking murder of a young man this summer. It happened exactly 4 months ago when a day of celebration at the St Paul's Carnival in Bristol culminated in a terrifying gunfight in the middle of a busy street. The reckless gunman hit several innocent bystanders, including this man. 21-year-old Rico Gordon.
Gunfights between gangs on our streets are thankfully incredibly rare. But when they do happen, the consequences can be indiscriminate and devastating. In July, 21-year-old Rico Gordon, a completely innocent man, was shot dead here, caught in the crossfire when two rival gangs from London brought their violence to Bristol.
Everybody loved Rico, you know, made everybody smile, everybody happy. That's why people love being around him. You felt privileged when he was around because he was just, he was so special. And, you know, his smile would just light up the room. he was against any kind of violence. He didn't like it. And, you know, if there would be a fight or something, he would be the first person to walk away.
He was the nicest person that I've ever met. The first person I'd think about when I woke up in the morning, first person I'd speak to, last person I'd speak to when I went to bed. I don't know, he can make you smile if you're feeling, like, sad. Even though I was in Bristol and he was in London, it kind of made things better, because when we did see each other, we appreciated each other a lot more.
On Saturday, the 2nd of July, the St Paul's Carnival in Bristol was in full swing. And Rico travelled down to see Maya and enjoy the festivities.
Yes, babe. Saturday. You're all right, babe.
Saturday.
Very
good to see you. So happy. You know, my friends loved him, so he met, like, I think most of my friends that night.
Yeah, well, I'm going to go now anyway,
though. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Baby. It's fun anyway. I'm going to give you a call later.
I was like, OK, I'm going off with my friends, I'll leave you, and I'll call you later, and then we can meet back up. And I knew that he'd planned to go out after, but I wasn't sure where.
Take care.
Bye, baby.
See you, darling. Rico spent the rest of the evening with a group of his friends, also in town for the carnival. Some of them had connections to a London gang. The whole group ended up at this pub in the eastern area of Bristol. And it's here that the police think that trouble began.
The pub had stayed open late for post-carnival partygoers, but at around 3:40 a.m, a confrontation broke out between two men, possibly members of the rival gangs. Rico didn't like the tense atmosphere in the pub and decided to leave. Shortly afterwards, a group of 16 men also left the pub and got into their cars, but they weren't going home. In convoy, they drive up Stapleton Road, past Rico and his friends, and decide to circle the area, turning left into St Mark's Road. Minutes later, the six-car convoy is back. They park up, blocking the entrance to Berwick Road, and some head on foot towards where Rico's group of friends are stood chatting.
I remember calling him and being like, OK, where are you now? I've called the taxi, it's on its way. And he was like, yeah, I'm coming. And I was like, well, if you're not here soon, I'm going to go to sleep. And he was like, yeah. And then it kind of just, like, cut out.
As the group approaches, a shot is fired at them from the other side of the road, sparking a gun battle.
Rico!
Over 20 bullets are fired. An innocent passerby gets hit in the leg. But the bullet that hits Rico is fatal.
I thought that, like, maybe he dropped his phone. And then, because I heard, like, a kind of bang, but it could have been the phone falling on the floor, because as soon as, like, he was speaking, and then it was kind of like, you know, when you can't finish a sentence. And then it just cut out, so I thought maybe he's dropped his phone and the battery's always broken. That's why I can't get through to him. And so I called, like, I kept calling after, and it just went straight down to the machine.
Wake up, Rico!
I wish that the phone conversation that we had was more, I don't know, like a better last conversation, if you know what I mean.
Rico was killed by a single bullet, which hit the pavement and ricocheted up into the back of his head. He didn't stand a chance. Detective Superintendent Sue Scott is now determined to find his killers.
Sue, we know that there were a lot of people around here.
This would have been very busy, and the people in the street at the time would have seen gunmen firing lots of shots into the street. They would have seen one of the gunmen zigzagging up the road behind us.
And you think, don't you, that they remained in the area whilst the police, whilst the ambulance service, are still here at the crime scene?
That's right. One of those vehicles in the convoy was driving around the back streets here at the same time the emergency services were desperately trying to save Rico's life.
You think it gets easier, but it doesn't. It does get a lot worse, because now, you know, you're sort of realising he's not there, and you're just missing him more and more. So every day gets harder.
I think the worst thing is, like, not having someone that you can tell everything. I don't know. It's just, I feel like a main part of my life is missing that isn't easily filled.
It's changed all of us. And, you know, it's like we're all broken and I'm just pleading for anyone who knows anything to come forward.
A terrible thing. We're joined now by Detective Superintendent Sue Scott. We saw her there from Avon and Somerset Police. Thanks for joining us. Clearly the family are devastated, no surprise about that. It is very important to let people know that this was a totally innocent young man.
Yes, Rico was not connected to gangs whatsoever. He was totally innocent. I can't stress that enough. Okay. And his family are devastated about this loss.
Let's talk about a lot of drama on the streets that night then. There was this convoy of six cars. What more can you tell us?
You can see from the CCTV that convoy is going in and around the area. And it's from that convoy later on that two of our gunmen, we believe, have come from.
There's another car you're interested in. Is it a dark blue Alfa Romeo?
It is a dark blue Alfa Romeo, which we're interested in because during the incident, the front passenger window was shot out. And then we believe that between the 3rd and the 6th of July, that window was replaced. We want to speak to the person who replaced that window.
OK, that's important. What do you know about the guns, Sue?
We know that there was three guns involved, handguns. We know they're hidden somewhere. We want to find them, so please, somebody phone in and tell us where we can find those guns.
OK, lots of people were on the streets that night. Presumably you're also trying to trace witnesses still?
We're still trying to trace witnesses, yes, we are. And there's three key witnesses I'd like to trace who were in the coach house that night, one of which was a man who we can see here with a long-sleeved white shirt on. We'd like to speak to him. A man in the blue Adidas tracksuit who you can see here, and the lady in the still here. What I want to stress to any witnesses who might be thinking about phoning in, we understand that you might be scared. There's a range of measures that we can put in place to make sure that we can protect you, but I'd urge you to phone us.
Yes, thanks very much. I mean, gang violence can make people worried, but you can reassure them that you will deal with them very sensitively indeed. If
Absolutely.
You know anything, then please do speak to the detectives here now, 0500 600 600, or you could call the independent charity Crime Stoppers completely anonymously. 0800 555 111 is their number. Now, Rav has got his first collection tonight of wanted faces.
And first tonight is this fella, Carl Michael O'Hare. The 29-year-old is wanted in connection with the murder of his father and the attempted murder of his mother in Liverpool in 2002. He skipped bail in January 2003 and hasn't been seen since. Now, this is an old photo of him, but he'll still have this prominent scar under his nose as a result of a hair lip. He should not be approached, so if you know where he is, just call the police immediately. Next, number two is Abdi Karim Ismail, and he's wanted for a serious sexual assault of a teenager in Cardiff in December last year. The 38-year-old, who's previously worked as a taxi driver, has links to South Wales, London and Northampton. Number three is Alexander Abimbola, who's wanted for dangerous driving and fraud in connection with a traffic collision which left the victim paralysed from the neck down. Police believe 40-year-old Abimbola, who regularly attends church, may be working as a courier. He has links to South East London and Nigeria. And lastly for now, number four is Graham Benjamin Phillips, previously known as Malcolm Cook. The 51-year-old registered sex offender is wanted in connection with the possession and importation of indecent images of children. Now, Phillips, who's originally from Hertfordshire, has links to Belgium, Cyprus and Germany. Now, all of tonight's faces are on the website, bbc.co.uk/crimewatch, and if you know where they are, 0500 600 600, or you can text 63399 crime, space, and then your message.
OK, it's time now for some updates on cases that we've featured previously.
Well, we start with news of an appeal from our last programme, the rape of a young woman who was trying to make her way home after a night out in Waltham Cross in Hertfordshire in July.
Hi, do you know where I can get a taxi from here?
Well, just a few days after the broadcast, a 23-year-old man from Waltham Cross was arrested on suspicion of rape and is currently on police bail. We'll keep you informed of how that case progresses.
Next, a man we've featured twice on the programme. This is Mohammed Ali Edge, who officers from South Wales were keen to speak to in connection with the murder of teenager Amir Siddiqui in Cardiff in April 2010. Well, last month, Edge was located and arrested in India. Police are now seeking his extradition back to the UK.
And the latest on a case from a decade ago. A teenage couple were walking along a towpath in Salisbury when they were approached by a man who threatened them with a gun and subjected the young woman to a serious sexual assault. Well, in September, a 57-year-old man from Salisbury was arrested and charged with false imprisonment and indecent assault, as well as firearms offences. He's due in court again in the new year, and we'll let you know what happens.
Now, a very sad story in which all these items here may hold the key to the death of a newborn baby, little boy, whose body was found in a stream in Lancashire last month. With me now is Detective Superintendent Neil Essien from Lancashire Constabulary. Thanks for joining us this evening, Neil. A very sad case. Tell me a little bit more about it.
As you say, a very sad case indeed. A couple were walking their dog in Kirkham, which is about 7 miles outside of Blackpool, around 2 p.m. on Saturday the 1st of October this year, when they found the body of a small child, we now know to be a baby boy, in a stream. That stream is known locally as Spen Brook, which is just off Car Lane at Kirkham.
What do you know, if anything, about how this little boy died?
Unfortunately, we don't know a great deal at this stage. We know it's a full-term child. We believe it to be white. It definitely wasn't premature.
Okay.
Unfortunately, because of the poor condition of the child, we don't know an awful lot more than that, and that's why we're appealing for help tonight.
When I was introducing this, I said that it was items that would hold the key, hopefully, to how and why this little boy died. Let's go through some of those items. Let's start with, I mean, it's such a tiny little thing, this. Obviously, it's a little baby jacket.
Yes, this was the jacket that the child was wearing at the time we found it. We've ascertained so far that it's from Asda, from their George range, and was sold as part of their autumn-winter range, 2008-2009. Of particular interest is that cartoon character, which seems to be emerging from the pocket. Yeah. Hopefully somebody will recognise that and come forward tonight.
So you know where it's from, but...
Yes, we know where it's from.
Yes. Bin bag, there's a bin bag that might be important.
Yes, near where the child was found, there was a Blackpool Borough Council black bin bag, just an ordinary bin bag.
Right.
But intertwined with that bin bag were two towels.
Right.
A green Renaissance towel and a Union Jack towel. Again, all those items, as is the, are very common, together with the baby grow, all very common. Individually, they're not greatly important to me, but linked together, I really need to know if anybody can link these together and try and trace the identity of the parents of this child.
Yes, it's the jigsaw of them all together. Now, there is a piece of the jigsaw that until now hasn't been revealed. Tell me what that is.
Yes, in the bin bag, we found the remnants of a cardboard box, and we've managed to piece together the fact it's actually a shoe box.
Right. So
it's from Evans. It's quite a large shoe box. And it's actually these shoes here, which are size 5, and they're from Evans. So if anybody can put those together with the other three items, it's vitally important they come forward tonight.
It's also important to stress for people watching that you don't know how it was that this little baby came to be in this stream.
No, we don't know. It could be a potentially serious crime, but it's also, whatever's happened, it's a tragedy. Out there is a mother who's probably desperately in need of our help, probably in need of medical attention, but certainly in need of emotional support. We want to come forward tonight, and we'll give her that support, but we really need to know what happened to that. That child and how it came to be in that stream.
Okay, thanks very much, Neil. Maybe you're the baby's mother, or indeed maybe you're the baby's father. Did you see anything around about that stream? 0500 600 600. If you'd rather speak to female officers tonight, then just ask when you make your call. Or you could call Crime Stoppers anonymously. Let me give you that number. 0800 treble 5 treble 1. Now it's time for some CCTV with Rav.
And we start in Liverpool.
It's the early hours of a Tuesday morning in April at an Asda supermarket in Bootle, Merseyside. A security guard waits in the cash machine vault. Little does he know that outside his colleague has been ambushed by two masked men. The attackers force their way into the vault, dragging the other guard with them. When inside, they threaten the guards with a gun and a piece of wood, before making off with several thousand pounds. Now you can't see their faces, but someone knows who they are. Names, please. More footage from April. This time we're inside the Level Bar in Warrington. It's just after midnight and the place is packed. One drinker, a guy with a distinctive swallow tattoo on his neck, takes offence as a fellow punter tries to get past him. Without saying a word and completely unprovoked, he headbutts the man. The victim needed stitches and is permanently scarred as a result of the attack. Use your head and name this thug tonight. Now this is low. Inside the Cancer Research charity shop in Skipton, North Yorkshire, during the early hours of a Thursday in May. a man wearing a rather fetching paper suit has broken in, and he isn't looking for a bargain or to make a donation. Though he clearly likes a rummage, but unlike his torch, he's not too bright. Hello. He stole money and watches donated to support a charity. Disgusting. Do your bit and tell us who he is.
That footage is all on the website, and if you know who any of them are, call 0500 600 600 or text 63399, type crime, space, and then your message.
Now a truly terrible murder that you surely can't fail to have heard about. Joanna Yates, Jo to her friends. She was, of course, a 25-year-old landscape architect who lived happily in Bristol with her boyfriend, Greg. That was until just before Christmas last year, when she was strangled in her own flat by her next-door neighbour, Vincent Tabak. In the light of his conviction last week, we can now bring you the full story of what happened. And for the first time, hear exclusively from Jo's parents, David and Teresa Yates, and from her brother, Chris.
The disappearance of Jo Yates just a week before Christmas devastated her family.
She had a brightness about her.
She was always very happy-go-lucky, always had time for everyone.
Well, she liked outdoor things, outdoor life. She was going to be a real success.
She had sports and interests, a great boyfriend, everything was there.
She and Greg had been going out for 2 years, and they were coming home for Christmas.
We were very excited about it. She had printed off the internet making mince pies, and I know that's what she was going to do part of that weekend. Time has just stopped from that night.
Jo was 25 and had everything going for her. She was beautiful, talented, and had settled in Bristol working as a landscape architect. She was living happily here with her boyfriend Greg until one night in December when she vanished. The investigation began on the 19th of December when police received a call from Jo's boyfriend.
On the Sunday evening, Greg returned from his weekend away in Sheffield, and there was no trace of Jo in the flat. And gradually, he started to piece things together that he thought were unusual. And when he rang her number, he could hear her telephone ringing within the flat. And as time progressed, he just got increasingly concerned, to such a stage that he eventually rang the police.
The circumstances, as they were reported and as I read them, automatically led me to feel that with this particular missing person, there was something wrong.
A missing persons inquiry was launched. Detectives were looking for anything that might point them towards Jo, but they had very little to go on.
We're exhausting every opportunity and every resource we have to try and find her. And we generally really do need some help.
Inside the flat, there were a few potential leads. One was a Tesco receipt for a pizza she'd bought on the Friday night 2 days earlier. The receipt had been left in the living room, but there was no sign of the pizza or its packaging. Police were convinced finding the pizza could lead them closer to Jo, so they started retracing her steps. Friday night, 6 p.m. Okay. Jo met friends for drinks at a pub on Park Street.
On Monday. Have a good one, okay?
Yeah. They remember her that night as her usual happy self.
Hi.
On the way home, she called her best friend and arranged to meet up on Christmas Eve.
Love you lots. Bye.
She then popped into a Waitrose supermarket, an off-licence,
and a Tesco Express, where she bought the pizza. This is the last ever recorded image of Jo. But what happened when she got home that night remained a mystery. A huge police search was underway. The Bristol Downs and the Avon Gorge were scoured for clues. Further appeals were also made. By now, Jo had been missing for over a week, but the investigation was about to change course.
I've got to say, it's a bit cold.
No, it's lovely.
Police received a call from a couple out walking their dog, 3 miles from Jo's flat. They'd spotted part of a body in the snow. It was Jo, fully clothed and curled up on her side.
The heavy snowfall meant she was barely visible and had lain unseen for several days.
Jo had been left on the side of the road, her body now frozen. It was Christmas Day.
She was, like, dumped there like a piece of garbage. That's where my daughter was last.
I was thinking, why, you know? There seemed to be no reason to it.
After her family identified the body, a post-mortem began.
The cause of Jo's death was manual strangulation. There was evidence that there had been, in the opinion of the pathologist, that there had been some sign of a struggle.
And crucially, they also found tiny traces of DNA on Jo's body belonging to someone else.
The investigation into the death of 25-year-old Joanna Yates is now a murder investigation.
Jo had been found fully clothed, except for a sock that was missing. Police hoped that recovering it, along with the pizza, could provide some answers. The news captivated the nation.
Good evening. The police say a body found yesterday on the outskirts...
The hunt was now on for her killer. The night Jo went missing, witnesses had heard screams in the area around her flat.
Those screams were of particular interest because it helped us to time when the actual incident happened within flat one, which resulted in Joanna's death.
But when detectives had knocked on the door of Jo's immediate neighbour, Dutch national Vincent Tabak, he claimed he hadn't seen or heard anything.
It was around about 4 o'clock on the Monday morning when two police officers, together with Greg, knocked on the door of flat two. They didn't have any information to provide us at that particular stage concerning her whereabouts.
Tabak's flat was later searched, but police found nothing. Seemingly out of the picture, he headed to the Netherlands with his girlfriend for New Year.
Their attention was then drawn to another of Jo's neighbours, her landlord. He was one of the few people with keys to her flat. His name was Christopher Jeffries.
Good evening, police hunting...
5 days after Jo's body was recovered, Jeffries was arrested. The tabloid press went into overdrive. Speculation about his supposed involvement was rife. But amazingly, just 3 hours after his arrest, an officer received a call from Vincent Tabak in the Netherlands, claiming to have new information.
He could remember that Chris Jeffries' car had been parked on the driveway at Canning Road in a particular position the evening before Jo went missing, and that the next morning the car was facing in the opposite direction.
What Tabak had to say was potentially crucial new evidence for police, who are now questioning Jeffries. On New Year's Eve, they sent a team out to meet him at a hotel in Amsterdam. But his version of events seemed confused.
Yes, yeah, as I say, the car...
There were details of Vincent's account that were concerning me. He was vague in some areas. He was over-interested in other areas, particularly around our forensic examination. There were things in his account that just didn't sound right to me. And then his reluctance to give his DNA at the end of the process, again, obviously started to ring some alarm bells.
Tabak's statement was a smokescreen. The landlord was entirely innocent. When police checked Jeffrey's DNA against the sample found on Joe's body, there was no match. He was freed without charge. As the investigation gathered momentum, police launched a Facebook campaign and turned to Crimewatch.
They've been painstakingly reconstructing every last detail.
Action!
As our team began to film an appeal, the press descended. Within hours, police received over 300 new calls. Then, shortly before the reconstruction was due to air, they made a dramatic breakthrough. Forensic scientists had spent weeks enhancing the tiny DNA sample found on Joe's body, enabling them to now establish a link to Vincent Tabak. The detective's suspicions were being confirmed.
I had a very strong gut feeling that something wasn't right.
Tabak was arrested and his possessions seized. They included his car, his mobile and his laptop. The secrets they contained would be hard for Tabak to explain away. They found that 6 days before her body was discovered, Tabak had been using Google Street View.
He was looking at Longwood Lane and in particular at the bit of Longwood Lane where he'd left Joanna's body. There was only one person in the world who knew where Joanna was, and that was Vincent Tabak.
Forensics examined his car for evidence. What they discovered confirmed what happened that night.
In the boot of the car, we were able to find minute traces of blood that was a match back to Joanna Yates.
The evidence was damning, and Tabak, the man next door, was charged with murder. Despite his refusal to answer any questions, detectives now had a better picture of what happened to Jo on the night she disappeared. Was overpowered by 6'4" Tabak, who gripped her throat, strangling her to death. That night, he bundled her body into his boot and went looking for a place to discard it. He even stopped at an Asda supermarket to text his girlfriend, telling her that he was bored. He, in fact, bought crisps, beer and rock salt while Joe's body lay in his boot. The whole exercise, an elaborate attempt to create an alibi.
These birds which sort of run along the ground working so hard and then they take to the air and start flying, and that to me is my daughter. She'd just taken off and somebody shot her down.
She's been stolen from us, but she had her life stolen from her.
Nearly 3 weeks after his arrest, Vincent Tabak confessed to a prison chaplain that he had killed Joanna Yates. He then pleaded guilty to manslaughter.
But the police were convinced he was guilty of murder, and so, last month, he went to trial at Bristol Crown Court. Tabak claimed he'd made a pass at Jo, causing her to scream, and while trying to silence her, had accidentally strangled her to death. But the prosecution believed the attack was intentional and sexually motivated. The trial ran for 13 days, with Tabak failing to answer 80 questions.
Then, after almost 14 hours of deliberation, the jury returned their verdict. Vincent Tabak was guilty of murder.
I grieve because I miss her, but she's missed so much as well.
Getting married, having children, and all these type of things, which I know that that's what she would want in the future. Nothing will replace my daughter. Nothing at all.
Such a tragedy, Matthew. The details that have come out since the trial finished, really shocking.
Sickening. Tabak was obsessed with violent pornography, specifically films showing women being choked during sex. He'd watched those films on the morning he killed Joe, and in the days afterwards, he was flicking continuously between reports of how the police investigation was progressing and those pornographic sites. He used prostitutes when he was away on business trips, and prosecutors believe he'd crossed the line from observer to perpetrator.
And yet none of that was heard at the trial.
No, it was inadmissible. He portrayed himself as being sexually naive. He said he'd killed Joe by accident. He even suggested she'd been flirtatious. I mean, it was grotesque. It was cold. It was calculating. He spent weeks researching the legal differences between murder and manslaughter. And he didn't give a damn about putting the family through that harrowing trial, just like he couldn't give a damn about hiding the body and the agonies that caused. It was all about him, and thankfully, the jury saw through it.
And what about the moment when he showed this sort of flash of arrogance?
Yes, he was just being too clever. That phone call he didn't have to make, trying to frame Christopher Jeffreys. It all unravelled after that. You saw Karen Thomas talking about that hunch. That led them to the DNA that would corner him. But it was a difficult, difficult investigation. I mean, after the trial, Christopher Jeffreys said that the police wasted time and resources on him that should have been focused elsewhere.
And at the trial, Tabak got, it was life plus 20 years, is that right?
Yes, and Joe's parents said that they hoped that Tabak's time in prison would be a living hell, and they said that they would never get over their loss. I mean, they just miss her.
Terrible thing. Right, still to come then tonight. The cyclist who stepped in to stop this man, he's suspected of trying to rape a young woman in Brighton.
I'd absolutely do it again. That's what everybody should do in that situation. I didn't think twice, and I don't see why anyone would, really.
And we'll hear from the 14-year-old boy who was blasted in both legs with a shotgun as he answered his front door.
I looked down on my leg, saw the holes in my trousers. It was kind of horrific.
And can you identify this man here, thought to have planted suspect devices in Canterbury? So that's all coming up very soon. But first, Matthew has the latest on what's been happening on the phones. Matthew.
Well, let's start off by interrupting Sue, who's in charge of that Rico Gordon investigation. Sue, you were just telling me you've had a couple of really good calls coming in.
We've had two really good calls. One particular is of interest, who identifies one of the images we saw on the CCTV, so that's excellent news. But I would really like the name of all three of the people we saw.
And have you had names so far?
We have had one name, which looks potentially that we could have the right identity for that one individual.
And that is significant. So that's what you wanted, wasn't it?
Absolutely.
Names. What about guns, cars, all that information?
Nothing on the guns and cars, but also we've got some other names that are put forward by somebody who didn't give their name. So I'd urge that person to give us a call back. We would really like to speak to them. That's really important information to this inquiry.
OK, if that was you calling, please call Sue. She's waiting here for that call. Let's get a little more on that sad case of a baby's body found in Lancashire. Neil is in charge of that one. Neil, what's coming?
Matthew, there are a significant number of calls relating to the items individually, the fleece jacket, the shoes, the towels. But what I really need is someone to put that cluster together, to link those items together, which will lead us to the identity of the mother. That will be our vital
clue. And you are desperate for that mother to come forward, aren't you?
Yes, the aim tonight is for that mother to come forward. I know it's difficult, I know it's... But I believe you really need our help. If you come forward tonight, tell us what's happened to your child. We will help you. We will provide that support. Please, please come forward.
OK, I hope you get some more calls on that one. Rav.
OK, time for some more wanted faces. And first is Dwayne Anthony Mullins. Early this year, he was convicted of raping a woman in 2004, but he failed to turn up at Sheffield Crown Court and was sentenced to 6 years in his absence. 35-year-old Mullins, who has a street name of Ribsy and is originally from Jamaica, has links to Sheffield and Doncaster. Number six is this fella here. This is Imran Shawket, and police want to speak to the 26-year-old in relation to a fatal hit-and-run incident that happened almost 2 weeks ago in Hassox in West Sussex. Shawket, who has two faint birthmarks on either side of his face, has links to Luton, London and Manchester. Now, take a look at this. Now, this is 56-year-old Robert Stevens, otherwise known as Robert Malias, robbing a bookmaker's at knife point in Bath in September. And police don't think it's the first offence he's committed. Stevens, who has connections across the West Country, has various tattoos, including a panther and the word City on his left arm and the letters B-O-B on his right hand. And lastly, for now, number eight is Neil Abdul Khalik, and police would like to talk to the 30-year-old in connection with two burglaries and a robbery, all committed in West London. Khalik, who's from Hounslow, is known by the street name of Tiny. So it's 0500 600 600 if you recognise any of them, or text 63399, type crime, space and then your message. And remember, they'll stay online until they're caught.
Now, take a moment to take just a little look at this image here. Well, police are confident that this man would have raped a young woman in Brighton if it hadn't been for the actions of a passing cyclist who came to her aid. Well, Detective Chief Inspector Nick Sloan from Surrey and Sussex Crime Team is here to explain more. Evening, Nick. Tell us a little more. What happened?
Well, the victim had been out for the evening with her family and was on her way home along Edward Street in Brighton, near the American Express building. It's quite a distinctive building in Brighton. As she walked along the road, she became aware of someone behind her, and they grabbed her, and it felt to her like it was a case of mistaken identity. The chap pulled away, and she walked on off the road. It was later on, about 2 minutes later, that he attacked her and pushed her to the ground and sexually assaulted her.
OK, I mean, just to get this right, it's a busy place, busy city centre place, this.
Yeah, it was a brazen attack. There was disregard to it. It was a well-lit dual carriageway road. And fortunately, our brave and the victim was acted in really dignified fashion, screamed and fought, and she was heard by a passing cyclist. And I have no doubt that if it hadn't been for the actions of the cyclist, she would have been subjected to a much worse ordeal.
Yeah, I mean, this bloke we're about to hear from is a bit of a hero. A hero, he also, it has to be said, is pretty modest too.
And it was just that moment, and so it was quite lucky timing-wise that I turned up when I did, and I chased up to him to try and get him to stop, and then he began to chase me away. I thought about following him, but I went back to the victim because she was on her own in the dark. Despicable, really. The guy was just horrible. Like, you know, what do you say about people like that? I'd absolutely do it again. That's what everybody should do in that situation. I didn't think twice, and I don't see why anyone would, really.
Yeah, despicable is the word. So CCTV, good CCTV, just give us a bit more detail.
Well, you can clearly see the offender. The CCTV cameras are very close to the scene, and you can see that he's wearing white trainers. He's got some jeans on with very distinctive braid around the pockets, and a black leather style type jacket, and a very distinctive Trilby hat, which he actually went back to pick up when he was being chased off by the cyclist.
Yeah, that really is very distinctive. As you say, the woman here, she's been very brave, very dignified. A terrible thing that happened. She is very keen that this man is caught.
I don't know why he did it. I don't know what led him to do what he did. So I can't know he's not going to do it again. And I don't think anyone else should have to go through that. So, and I'd just like to know why. I want to know why he chose that night, what led up to it, and why he chose me. You know, there's a lot of questions that I'd quite like to get answers to. The next person might not be so lucky.
A brave woman, DCI Nick Sloan, thanks very much for joining us this evening. If you recognise the man that we saw there, then it is time to pick up the phone tonight. 0500 600 600. If you have been a victim of crime, then of course you can call the victim support line. I'll give you their number. 0845 30 30 900. Now, Rav's got some more CCTV.
Yep, and we start this time in Bath.
A group of lads is gathered outside Bodrum's Takeaway in Broad Street in May. It all seems friendly,
until the guy in the body warmer starts getting aggressive. Suddenly, he punches the man in the blue shirt, knocking him over the railings and into the road, before casually striding off. This man broke someone's jaw. Name him tonight. Now, this is what I call brazen. This man is looking at expensive diamond rings in a jeweller's in King's Lynn in Norfolk last month. He asks the shop assistant to show him a variety of bespoke pieces before snatching one ring and legging it out of the shop. This is the ring he took, and it's worth just shy of $100,000. So go on, be a diamond and tell me who he is.
Remember, all the clips stay online until they're caught. So if you recognise anyone, you know what to do. 0500 600 600. Or you can text us on 63399. Type crime, space, and then your message.
Now, on an evening in March, 14-year-old Khalil Hogan went to answer a knock at his front door for his house in High Wycombe in Buckinghamshire. But as he opened the door, he was shot twice in the legs by a complete stranger who targeted Khalil's house by mistake.
My first grandson, and as a person, he's a very nice lad. He's really, really quiet. Sometimes he'll be in the room and you wouldn't know he was there.
I live with my nan and my sister and her boyfriend in High Wycombe. I've lived here for most of my life.
He lives for his sports. You know, he does football, rugby, rounders.
One thing people always talk about to me is sports, because they all know that I'm a very active person. They know that I like to play sport all the time. I can play a wide range of sports as well, but I like football most.
On the night of the shooting, I came home from work, like I normally do, and at 8 o'clock, I left Khalil, his sister, and her boyfriend to go to prayer meeting.
See you later.
Bye-bye.
Because normally I like to know when I go out there's somebody here with him.
That evening I was just on the computer talking to my friends on Facebook and on playing some games just to relax while my sister was watching some TV. Basically a normal night for us.
Please.
There was a knock on the door. My sister asked me to get it, so I did. No one was there for about 2 seconds. I looked down at my leg, saw the holes in my trousers, and there was blood dripping from my legs onto the floor. It was kind of horrific.
I got down the end of the road and I saw all these police cars and police with guns. So I came and I asked what happened, and they told me he was gone in the ambulance.
I woke up in a hospital bed with loads of doctors and a few nurses standing around me.
There was a big gaping hole in his right leg, and the flesh was all smashed up.
I spent 2 weeks in hospital. I had 4 operations in total. They had taken out all the junk and pellets in my leg.
There was a lot of pellets a lot of pellets.
The doctors were telling me that they weren't sure if I'd be able to walk again. They thought I might have been paralysed.
He should never have gone through what he did. He's just an innocent boy. It was frightening for him. And he went through a lot of pain and suffering for nothing.
When I kept going back over it in my head, I didn't really know why someone would do something like this to me. Because I've always been a quiet person, never got into much trouble. So I don't really understand why trouble has come to me.
Well, we're joined now by DCI Joe Kidman from Thames Valley Police. A lot of pain and suffering, his grandmother said, that's for sure. What possible reason could there have been for an attack on this lovely young boy?
Well, all of our inquiries have found no positive reason why Khalil or anyone who lives with him at his home should have been attacked. That leaves us with the very real possibility that this is a case of mistaken identity.
Yeah, OK. So what are you looking for tonight? What information do you need?
We really need the help of the local community. In particular, excuse me, in particular, we've got some CCTV that hasn't previously been released.
Right.
And that shows two people were involved in the shooting. It's those two people that we really want Crimewatch viewers to help us to identify.
OK, so let's take a really good look at that. Yes, as you certainly say, Joe, we've got the CCTV. Just tell us what viewers are seeing here.
Yes, this is a few moments before the attack, and these two individuals are going towards Khalil's home.
Yeah.
The first one was carrying what we say is a shotgun, and then a minute or so later, running back from where they come from.
You're interested in particular in what one of them was wearing. We'll slow down this CCTV and take a look.
Yes, this first man, on his darker jacket, it appears that there's a logo, a rectangular logo, and then towards the centre, there's something that reflects the light even more.
Right, yeah, that is quite distinctive, and people can take a look at that on our website. This young boy has made good progress, has he? Because we heard he was keen on sports and so on.
Yes, he has. I'm pleased to say that despite the injuries that he suffered, he has gone back to school and is playing football again.
That's good news. We wish him all the very best. If you know anything, I would urge you, please, to call now. You've seen the suffering this poor boy went through. 0500 600 600. Now, it's time for some more news on previous appeals.
Well, we start with a case we featured back in 2006, the terrifying rape of a young woman who'd become separated from her friends after a night out in Bromley in Kent. We showed you this CCTV of a man police believed to be responsible. Well, thanks to a DNA breakthrough, the attacker was identified as 34-year-old Cheslin Camphor of no fixed abode. And 2 weeks ago, he was given an indeterminate prison sentence. He'll serve at least 4.5 years, and Camphor will be deported back to South Africa when he's released. A great result.
Now, you might recognise this guy as he was a wanted face on our last show. He's 40-year-old Mohamed Bashiri, who had tried to blackmail an 83-year-old pensioner out of her lottery winnings. Well, as a direct result, of course, of the programme, he was located and is now serving at least 2 years in prison. Nice one.
And finally, this CCTV of an attack which took place outside the Eastside pub in Ilford in Essex in July 2010, which we appealed about last November. It shows a doorman being slashed across the face with a weapon. He needed 50 stitches and is permanently scarred. The man responsible for the attack was identified as 28-year-old Lennox Richards from Barkingside in London. And in August, he was sentenced to 5 years for GBH. A great result.
Now, we've got a particularly unusual case in which two suspect devices were planted in Canterbury, including one left in the baby change area of the town's Marks & Spencer's store. With me now is Detective Chief Inspector Tom Richards from Kent Police. Really unusual case, this, Tom. Tell me a bit more.
Well, it was 4:20 in the afternoon on Friday the 26th of August. That was the bank holiday weekend.
Yeah.
And we received a call that there was a suspect device on the railway line at Old Dover Road in Canterbury. While we're investigating that matter, the fire alarm activated in the baby changing room of Marks & Spencer's in the Whitefriars shopping centre within Canterbury.
Yeah.
We investigated that, and that too was a suspect device that had actually activated, issuing very thick smoke, causing a great deal of distress to shoppers.
Right, now we've got pictures, you've brought us pictures of both of these devices, as you say, you know, quite complex looking things. Mm. The first one is the one that was found by the railway line, a pretty terrifying looking device actually. And let's just take a look. You say there was thick smoke in the baby change area of M&S, and there, once the smoke cleared, this was what was left, this small explosive device, happened within an hour of each other. I can only imagine you're linking the two incidents, right?
Yeah, we are. We regard this as an incident committed by one group who meticulously planned and organised and executed this. Motive is still a mystery to us. Nobody's claimed responsibility, which is quite unusual in these cases, but clearly their plan was designed to cause maximum disruption to the authorities and the public of Canterbury.
OK, you've got some really interesting CCTV on this one. Let's take a look at it. Tell viewers what they're watching at home.
We're looking at the man that we believe placed the device in Marks & Spencer's in Canterbury. You see him here in the store. He spends about 15 minutes there. He places the device and then he leaves. Almost as soon as he exits the store, the device activates, filling the store with smoke. As you can see, he appears to be dressed as a cyclist, and we do have evidence that he got around Canterbury on a pushbike.
OK, and he was walking there with great purpose. You don't think he was working alone. You think, as you say, he's part of a tight-knit team. Why is that?
Well, we've established now that at least three mobile phones were used on the day of the offence. They used them to communicate between each other, but they also used them to contact the media and also to contact Kent Police and claim that they'd found the device. What we do have now is some footage that I'd really like help from the viewers with, which is footage of three women who actually purchased the phones in the West End of London 2 weeks before the offence on Sunday the 14th of August.
Right, that's an interesting picture. Now, nobody was hurt, but you were taking this very seriously. Briefly, why?
Well, we're treating it seriously, as it was so organised, it was so meticulous in its planning, and the devices were clearly designed to scare people.
That's for sure, Tom. Thanks very much. Do you recognise any of those people that we've just seen? If so, we urgently need to hear from you tonight. You know the number. It's 0500 600 600. Now, time for a quick last update from Rav.
Yeah, we're getting some good information already on the Rico Gordon murder in Bristol. The 21-year-old lad, here he is, caught in the crossfire, completely innocent. Now, several calls giving names for possible gang members that may have been there at the time, and names for one of the witnesses that was possibly in that pub. We'll need that person to come forward. Very quickly, getting lots of calls about the baby top that was worn on the baby that was found in Kirk, and we don't need any more information about that top. We know where it's from, we just need to link it to this poor baby boy. More in the update show to follow.
Thanks, Rav. That's everything for now, then. Remember that you can view all of the reconstructions, the wanted faces, the CCTV online. You can also do it on your smartphone, do it on your tablet. Just log on to bbc.co.uk/crimewatch. The phone lines stay open until midnight tomorrow, so there's still plenty of time to call. We're going to be back again, of course, in just 35 minutes after the news. We'll have a full update on all the calls that you've made tonight. But until then, please do keep on phoning. Thanks for viewing, and we'll see you in a little while. Bye-bye for now.